Hi, I'm Shelley, and I'm here at the Smithsonian's National Zoo and Conservation Biology Institute in Washington, D.C. We learned that animals have adaptations that help them survive in the wild. Now, while survival isn't at the top of our animals' minds here at the zoo, their adaptations are still important parts of who they are and important in our care for them. Today, we're at the zoo's small mammal house to learn about an unusual career that deals with animal adaptations. Before we meet our guest, I'm going to give you three clues. Can you guess what they do? First, they work in teams. Second, they must be very observant. And third, they use science to care for animals. Can you guess what they do? Let's go find out.
Hey there, I'm Mimi, one of the animal keepers here in the Small Mammal House at Smithsonian's National Zoo. Right behind me, we have some of our golden-headed lion tamarins. Today, we're going to be talking about all of the animals and their adaptations and why we as keepers have to tune all of our care to specifically cater to the animal's needs. All of these adaptations are shown in the over 30 different species we have in just this unit. One of the ways we ensure our animals get the specific care that they need is by learning about their adaptations. An adaptation can be any behavioral or physical change that will help the animal really live and thrive in its natural environment. So it's going to tell us a lot about what they eat, how they maneuver around their space, and that's how we can learn what kind of enrichment to give them. So one of those ways that we're going to really be thinking about the animal adaptations that they have is when we're putting in enrichment. Now, Small Mammal House has a lot of different types of enrichment for all of our 30 different species of animals, including Kongs. This might look really familiar to any of you all who have dogs. You might be putting some peanut butter on this for your dogs to really have to work hard or stick their tongue in here to get more of that peanut butter out. We're gonna do the same thing for all of our animals. We give Kongs to our armadillos, some of our monkeys. We can also hang them up in the air so that they have to work a little bit harder with them swinging. We've got a lot of different types that we're gonna think about. What adaptations are going to make animals work a little harder. For our animals that are going to use their feet and their fingers or hands a little bit more, we have puzzle feeders. For our animals that have a really nice sense of smell, but not quite good dexterity, maybe some of these slow feeders that they have to like really get into. We have as well some plastic tube feeders for our tamanduas with those really long tongues and their snouts that they can stick all the way into this hole and get into their bugs and different things like that. A whole lot of different options for the enrichment.
Let's take a look at the brush-tailed baton.
Brush-tailed batons are a marsupial. I have a long word there. A marsupial means that they have a pouch, kind of like a kangaroo, which you may be more familiar with. They have a pouch and they are also bipedal. Bipedal means that they're going to be using their back legs as their primary use for moving around. You can see when she hops around, she's really engaging those back legs. She's got really strong legs to jump and move around. And she just uses her front legs a little bit to guide her when she's sniffing and deciding where she's going to dig and forage. So right now I am building some enrichment for our brush-tailed baton. I'm adding some shredded newspaper into this foraging bin that she was going to use her adaptation of digging. She's really good. She's got these little sharp claws that she can dig into the ground and forage for any types of different bugs or food in the ground in the wild. So I'm putting this shredded paper in this bin as well as some corn in here so that she can be rewarded for using that adaptation and get some goodies. She's gonna dig around in this shredded newspaper looking for all of those treats. And she may afterwards even take this shredded newspaper and carry it around in her tail to help her bed. Brush-tailed batons have a prehensile tail that helps them maneuver their substrate and help them make their bedding. So you can see she's got all of this hay in this exhibit and she's going to use her tail to gather it up into a little scoop roundup pile, and she's gonna carry it around with her while she jumps around and gathers up different supplies that she can build her nest and sleep at night. Now, brush-tailed batons, I say at night, but their nighttime is different than our nighttime. So they are a nocturnal species, which means that they are awake in the nighttime and asleep in the daytime. So you can see her exhibit is red right now. That is because she has a reverse light cycle here at the zoo. The reverse light cycle means that in her exhibit, it is nighttime while it is our daytime, so that when you come and visit, you can see her awake and moving around. And then when it is our nighttime, those lights are going to switch to be nice and bright as if it was daytime in her exhibit, and that gives her the signal to go to sleep.
Now let's take a look at the naked mole rat.
This is our naked mole rat exhibit. Now, naked mole rats are probably our most unique species in the wild. They're going to be living completely underground. This exhibit has lots of different chambers and lots of different tunnels to show what it would look like underground in a really complex environment. Since they live completely underground, they have a really, really strong sense of smell and a really strong sense of hearing. Because they're underground, it's dark all the time, so they don't really need to be able to see. So naked mole rats are essentially blind. Naked mole rats have a really interesting adaptation. They've got super strong jaw muscles, and that is how they use those teeth to dig around and dig these tunnels. Naked mole rats are a mammal, which means that they have to have hair. So they're using the hairs in between their toes, kind of like a broom. You can see this guy here is using his feet to dig around and move that substrate. One of the keeper's jobs in Small Mammal House is to build our exhibits specifically in tune for those animal adaptations and those animal characteristics. We've got all of these different types of branches and perching and grapevine, all of the stuff out here we use to build our exhibit. We're gonna use the thinner materials for our smaller monkeys or animals with smaller grip. And we're gonna use some of these larger pieces of perching for those really more heavy duty animals like the tamanduas, which are gonna really grip onto things with their claws and pull themselves up and maybe dig into that bark and really investigate and explore their exhibit a bit more.
What advice do you have for young people who might wanna become a zookeeper?
So if you're interested in zookeeping, right now when you're young, I say definitely read all about animals, try and visit your local zoos or any kind of animal facility that you might be interested in. Ask lots of questions to your parents, to your teachers. There's no such thing as a silly question. It's all there to help you learn and to grow. And then once you're older, you can start volunteering at your local zoo or any kind of animal organization, and that's gonna help you get that experience to build up your knowledge and skills.
Thank you so much for joining as we made career connections and learned about the unusual career of an animal keeper. I loved hearing how animal keepers like Mimi learn about animal adaptations in order to better care for their animals. That might explain why the wallaby Joey is being such a pouch potato. Thanks for watching.